Good morning or good afternoon, everyone, depending on what part of the country you're in, and thanks very much for joining us. Welcome to the itSynergy Hacking the Human series. Today we're viewing episode 5, which is on ransomware, so let's jump right in and get started. So first of all, just a little bit of background about itSynergy. Our why is creating positive experiences with technology. And so if you think about that moment when you first got maybe a new phone or a new gadget for the first time, or somebody showed you a new app that you've never seen before, maybe you were able to get something done faster because of technology, that moment, that feeling that you get at that moment where you're like, wow, this is really cool, that's what we call a positive experience with technology. And we do what we do in order to create that feeling. So let's talk a little bit about why we're here today. Let me share with you some statistics. So in 2014, IBM did a study, and that study showed that 95% of all security incidents involved human error. CompTIA followed that up in 2015 with another study where they found that human error accounts for 52% of the root cause of security breaches. And in the same year, Experian did a study that says employees and negligence are the leading cause of security incidents but remain the least reported issue. And so our goal in the next 14 minutes is to give you some quick action items to help you be security smart. And of course, today's topic is on ransomware. And I would encourage anyone who is here with us today to join us on the second Thursday of every month at 11:30 in the morning, Arizona time, for a new 15-minute topic. So today we're going to be talking about ransomware. So let's jump in and get going. So first of all, let's quantify the problem a little bit and talk about what is ransomware and why is it such a problem. Well, in 2016, this year, ransomware jumped to the number 2 spot on the list of top malware varieties. And this is from the Verizon 2016 Data Breach Investigations Report. Verizon puts out a big study every year about data breaches. And it jumped to the number 2 spot, which was the biggest jump of any category since 2015. And in fact, according to the Department of Justice, there have been 4,000 attacks daily in 2016, and that's up from 2015 from attacks in the hundreds per day, up to 4,000 attacks daily in 2016. The most common method of crimeware installation, so ransomware crimeware is just another way of saying ransomware, is by email attachments, followed very closely by what's called a web drive-by. And we'll talk a little bit about drive-by downloads here. And drive-by download is effectively means that you are infected merely by viewing a web page. So one of the common misconceptions when it comes to ransomware is that you actually have to click on something or download something or run an executable file or something like that. That is not the case. In drive-by downloads, all that the bad guys have to do is tempt you to click a link in your browser. And what happens is that link takes you to a web page which exploits unpatched browser components like plugins or other technology that the browser uses like Flash, Java, etc. Or sometimes even a bug in the browser itself, whether it's Chrome or Internet Explorer or whatever it might be. And by using those bugs that are in the web browsers, they can cause an infection just by viewing that web page without you taking any further action other than just looking at the web page. Another very interesting thing about malware, a lot of people ask us all the time, well, I have antivirus software, do I need to be worried? 99% of malware hashes are seen for only 58 seconds or less. So what does that mean? A hash is like a version of malware. So if you think about, say, Microsoft Office, there's the 2016 version, there's the 2013 version, there's the 2010 version. We all know Microsoft puts out new versions of their software every few years. What we're saying here is that the bad guys are effectively putting out a new version of malware on average every 58 seconds. And so what does that mean for antivirus? Well, antivirus looks for a particular signature or a particular file name, file type, etc. Well, if that information is changing every 58 seconds, unless you're updating your antivirus software every 57 seconds, which is unlikely, then most likely antivirus software is not going to be able to detect and prevent the ransomware. And so this just reflects how quickly hackers are modifying their code to avoid detection by the antivirus software. And it's also indicative of how many bad guys are out there that are actually creating variants of ransomware, that they can change it that quickly. And finally, where does ransomware come from? organized crime syndicates are the primary perpetrators of ransomware. And so keep in mind, when you're dealing with ransomware, you're not dealing with a teenage hobbyist hacker who's sitting in his parents' basement trying to break into the local school or whatever else. You're dealing with very large, very sophisticated, very well-run organized crime syndicates, often overseas. So now that I've put all that data out there to scare you, you say, I'm in. What do I do about it? So let's talk first about how you get ransomware, and then we'll talk in the second part of the webinar about what to do once you get ransomware. So first thing is that 93% of phishing emails contain some form of ransomware. And when I say they contain some form of ransomware, that means they either have an attachment, which if you can be tempted to click on that attachment, will infect you with ransomware, or they contain a link, which if you can be tempted to click on that link, will cause a drive-by download or possibly take you to a page that will ask you to download a file or view just that web page, and you'll be infected with ransomware. So we had a previous seminar on phishing emails, and so that is 93% of those. That's actually what they're doing, is trying to get you to take on some ransomware. So the payload, like I mentioned, is generally a link or an attached file. It can be either one. And like we've talked about with the drive-by downloads, that all you have to do is click on the link, or if it's a file, open the file, and that's all it takes to be infected with ransomware. So a lot of people sometimes will say, hey, you know, it's just a Word document, or it's just an Excel spreadsheet. Do I need to be worried about that? Absolutely. Any attached file could potentially contain a ransomware payload. Likewise, any link that you click on, even if you immediately close the browser, or you don't read it, or you don't click any links on the page that you go to, any of that doesn't matter. Just clicking on the link in the ransomware email can be enough to cause you an infection. Another thing that you need to be careful about is that there are some email clients that allow you to click an attachment to see a preview of the attachment directly in your email client, like Microsoft Outlook or whatever else that might be. In some rare cases, even doing that can also cause some type of an infection. And so you need to be very careful about doing that type of thing, because even previewing the file without opening it still causes some things to happen on the back end where the file actually does open and you end up with ransomware. So another thing that we always talk about, and we've talked about this before, but when it comes to looking at suspicious emails and trying to detect whether it's valid, you know, whether somebody has validly sent you an attachment, whether it's safe to open, etc. There's an excellent analogy which Microsoft put out a number of years ago, which is the sandwich analogy. And so if you think about when you receive a suspicious email, or when you download a program, maybe an app for your phone, maybe an attached file like a Word document, what you need to do is use the sandwich thought process. So think through this. If you're walking down the street one day, and a stranger walks up to you and says, hey, would you like a sandwich? Probably the answer is going to be no. It's very unlikely that you're going to accept a sandwich from a stranger walking down the street. Now, what if you're walking down the street someday and unexpectedly out of the blue, your best friend comes up and says, hey, you want a sandwich? Now, in that case, you know the person, but you're going to say, this is odd. Normally, you know, we see each other on the weekends. You know, we kind of hang out. Our families get together, whatever else. It's Tuesday afternoon, and I'm just walking down to the cafeteria to get some food. It's odd that you're here now when I didn't expect to see you, and you're offering me a sandwich. So maybe you'll accept the sandwich, maybe you won't, but certainly even if you do, it's going to be with a lot of suspicion, and you're going to try to figure out, like, what's going on here? Something's not right. Now, the third scenario, if you are at the park with your friend on the weekend, and you're at a picnic, and you guys have both agreed to bring some food, in that case, if your friend offers you a sandwich, then absolutely, of course, you're going to take the sandwich. And so if you think about those three scenarios, in one scenario, it's from somebody I don't know, and I don't know what it is, so I'm absolutely going to say no to that one. In the second scenario, it's from somebody I know, so imagine getting an email from someone you know, but you're not expecting it, or the contents of the email don't seem right. In that case, you want to be very suspicious about accepting that email and opening the attachment. And in the third scenario, the email is coming from somebody I know, and I'm expecting to receive it. And so in that case, in the overwhelming majority of cases, you're probably okay going ahead and opening the attached Word document or clicking the link that the person you know has sent you. The next thing to think about when it comes to ransomware is that the best defense is a good offense. So I cannot stress enough how important it is when it comes to ransomware to have a good backup that you know that you can rely on. So backup, backup, backup. And with the technology that's out there today, you should really be backing up your data multiple times per day. There's no reason not to do this. The technology is such that you can do backups very quickly. You can do them multiple times during the day. And so there's no reason not to do that. And this is by far the best defense against ransomware. Also important to realize that personal services such as Dropbox or other cloud-based services, OneDrive, Google Drive, etc., only back up on a file level basis, and that can make mass restores difficult. So one of the things that we're going to talk about what ransomware does is it will go out and encrypt all your files. Well, if all of your files are sitting in a Dropbox, Dropbox makes it very easy to go to a previous version of that file on a file by file basis. But if you have 1,000 or 10,000 or 100,000 files sitting in a Dropbox, there's no way that you're going to be able to sit there and restore them all one by one. And so it's a good idea when it comes to something like these services that you've got some other type of solution in place for backup so that you don't have to sit there and do it one by one. Final thing when it comes to backup is you've got to be very careful about restricting access to your backup files. One of the things that the ransomware vendors have learned is that a backup is the best defense against ransomware, and so they have rewritten their software so that it will not only encrypt your Word documents, your Excel spreadsheets, etc., but it will also go out and encrypt your backup files as well. And so you've got to make sure that those backup files are not connected or not accessible from the same computers that have access to the internet so that you don't encrypt your backup files, in which case they've just disabled all of your defenses. And then finally, you've got to think about the cloud. What about your data in the cloud? Is that data backed up? Are you going to be able to get it back? And do you have some sort of a strategy for recovering the data that's sitting in the cloud? So now let's say you didn't listen to anything I've just said. You've managed to get ransomware. Your screen looks like this. You've just gotten the ransomware screen, and they're demanding payment, and you have, in this case, 95 minutes left to go. What do you do? Number one, disconnect the source. So if you happen to know the machine that is the source of the infection, physically disconnect it from the network as quickly as possible. The reason is that the bad guys are not only going to encrypt files that are located on that machine, but they're also going to look for other machines that are on the network, network drives, etc., and they're going to go out and encrypt all of those as well. So if you're working for an organization, you've possibly not only just infected yourself, but you've infected the rest of your company as well. And so that's why you want to pull the cord out of the wall or out of the back of the computer as quickly as possible if you realize that you've been the victim of a ransomware attack. And that will help you to prevent the spread of the infection and keep it contained only to where it originally came in. Tip number two, do the cleanup first. So if you have not completely removed the ransomware from your environment, doing anything else like restoring backups or getting files back or whatever else is completely pointless, because as soon as you bring them back, the bad guy is just going to re-encrypt what you just brought back. And so there's no point in even starting to try to recover your data until you've completely cleaned everything up and gotten rid of the ransomware. Next up is you have to decide whether you're going to report the incident or not. The FBI encourages people to file reports, saying that even minor details can help. So if you have the email address of the person that is demanding the ransom, if you have any technical specifics about it, any other information that you can pass along, the FBI does encourage you to report that. That being said, I'm not sure how effective that is. I'm not sure that that's actually going to help you get back your data. And certainly, it's probably not going to help you get back your data in a timely fashion. So if you do decide that you want to report the ransomware, this is the website that you can do it at, ic3.gov. And you may want to consider this option whether you are a direct victim or an indirect victim, i.e., your information was held by some third party, maybe a healthcare provider or something along those lines, and it was stolen as part of an attack on their company. So in that case, you may also want to report that to the FBI as well. The next step in terms of defense, if you don't have a good backup, is you can try the strategy of what I call hacking the hackers. So there are a number of security organizations that have actually hacked the bad guy's software and reverse engineered it to decrypt your files for you without paying the ransom. So I have a number of links here Probably the best one is the second one down, nomoreransom.org, where you can upload a file that has been encrypted by ransomware and they will scan it and tell you if they have the decryption key to unlock that file based on hacking the software. So if they do, they will give that to you for free, and then you can essentially thumb your nose at the ransomware provider because you have the keys to unlock your files. And again, there are a number of other links that you can try here as well. And if you don't get all these down, you're more than welcome to email me at the end of this webinar. My email is at the end of it, and I'd be happy to send you these links. Your next option, which is always an option, is, of course, to pay up. I would generally view this as one of the last options. The debate rages on as to the merits of this path, whether you should pay up or not. If you are going to pay, use a gift card. Do not use your actual credit card. Keep in mind what you're doing here is effectively handing your payment details over to an organized crime syndicate, so you do not want to give them the primary credit card that you use every day. A lot of times these organizations will also demand payment in Bitcoin. That is a much more challenging path. It's not super easy to pay via Bitcoin. Also realize that Bitcoin, unlike a credit card, is not a reversible transaction. So you cannot protest a Bitcoin like you can with your credit card charge and attempt to get the money back. Also, every time I see a study, the statistics are a little bit different. But the range is that paying to unlock your files is only successful somewhere between 50 and 80% of the time. So even if you pay, you're not 100% guaranteed to get your files back. There's a little bit of a debate here. Some people say, well, these organizations want to have a good reputation because they want people to continue to pay them, and therefore they will honor the payment and unlock your files. There are others that say that simply designates you as a victim. If you agree to pay the ransom, that tells the bad guys you don't have a backup. There are cases where they will raise the ransom after you agree to pay it, or there are other cases where they say, aha, we've got a live one on the line and someone who's willing to pay, and so let's go after them even more. So that's what we have for today. I hope this very quick 15-minute webinar has been useful for you. Our next webinar is coming up December 8, again at 11:30 a.m. Arizona time. The registration is live right now, so you can literally go out right now and register for next month's webinar at itsynergy.com/webinar. We'll be talking about updates next month, and I think that will be an interesting one because I think when it comes to updates, a lot of people figure they just set their computer to automatic and then don't need to worry about it anymore. That is absolutely not the case, and so I would encourage you to attend next month to learn more. Our webinars are the second Thursday of every month at 11:30 a.m. Arizona time. There I am. There is my email address. If you'd like any of the links, have any questions, or would like any other information from today's presentation, I would encourage you to reach out. And I would also encourage you to spread the word about these webinars if you've enjoyed it. You can have anybody send an email to info@itsynergy.com. Of course, these webinars are free and always will be free, and we'd love to have as many people participate as possible. So thank you very much for joining, and I hope you have a great week.